Good at talking. No. Good afternoon, everybody. Warm welcome to you all. It's so lovely to have such a crowd come and see our Nigerian dream team assembled here. I wanted to first thank Gothenburg Film Festival for organizing and curating such a wonderful panel. It's not so often in Sweden that we get to have such illustrious guests. I think we need to expand our understanding of African film in general, but also specifically Nollywood and beyond, which is the title of this panel. I'm going to start first by introducing everybody on stage and then discussing a little bit about the history of Nigerian cinema and move into the new wave, and then we can take some questions. Does that sound good for everybody? Yes. At the end there, we have one of, I would say, Nigerian cinema's most famous directors, Mr. B. Bandele, who, who is, I think, best known for his adaptation of Chimamanda Adichie's novel Half of a Yellow Sun, which featured at Gothenburg in 2014, and also at Cinema Africa in Stockholm in 2014. B is here to represent his film 50, which has done so well in the festival. It's been sold out. And he is coming from a background in theater as well. So that's very interesting. Next, we have Inya Lawal. She is a mover and shaker in the Nigerian film industry, too. She is a talent manager. She represents a lot of the big name actresses and actors and does consulting work with directors as well. So we're very fortunate to have you here. Justine Powell is Senior Vice President at Iroko. How many of you know Iroko, by show of hands? Okay. It is the largest online platform VOD for Nigerian Nollywood films. So she has a lot to say about distribution. We're going to ask her specifically on that topic. And then... CJ Obasi is, I would say, one of the newest and brightest stars of Nigerian New Wave cinema. His film O-Town is being featured in this festival right now to sold out venues. And I think that he is someone to watch for sure in the future. So we have to keep an eye on this guy.
Talk.
And closest to me, Shaibu Hosseini, I would say that he is a living archive of Nigerian cinema. Ask him anything, and he knows the answer. He is... He is a documentarist of Nigerian cinema, which means that he not only has extensive knowledge, but he writes prolifically. He has major contacts in the film industry around the world, so he's constantly traveling, representing Nigerian cinema. And he was once a professional dancer. Yes. I'm Dina Afkampour. I am running Cinema Africa Film Festival. We are a yearly African film festival in Stockholm. And this year's edition is February 25th to the 28th. I welcome you all to come. It would be great to have you. And I'd like to start by saying I'm not a Nollywood expert. I'm not a Nigeria expert. I'm a generalist when it comes to African films. And really, I'm just here to try to ask the right questions. We have a major knowledge gap here in Sweden. So I think that we are very blessed to have everyone here on this panel. I want to start with Shaibu Yu. Please take us through the early days of Nigerian cinema, especially post-independence, the 1970s, films by Hubert Ogunde, Adeyemi Afolayan, Jabadu. Let's start there.
All right. Thank you so much. And it's a pleasure to be here and a privilege to be on this panel. Mm-hmm. And talking about cinema in Nigeria, of course, our colonial masters handed us the film office when they left. And after they left, we converted that office to the Nigerian Film Office. And we had some early sets of practitioners who worked with the colonial masters who had to be sent up to Ghana and to the UK for training. And by the time they came back, the Nigerian film industry took off around the 70s when we had practitioners like Ola Balogun, Chief Ejiogboma, the late Chief Hubert Ogunde, and Adelov, Kunle Afolayan's father. So they made films on the bigger gauge, that is on celluloid, in the 70s. And these films were widely shown in Nigeria. They also took the films around and were very popular. And interestingly, some of those films even traveled to big festivals abroad. But as they continued, things got very bad because back there in Nigeria, we didn't have studios to produce the film. So most of the time after shooting, they have to go to the UK and to America to edit and then to get the film processed. So when economy dipped in the country, there was this structural adjustment program that was introduced by the military and it affected foreign exchange. It was difficult for them to raise money to go to process celluloid films abroad. So it dropped. At the time they started in the 70s, we were making up to 4 celluloid films in a year. We're making up to 6 or 5 celluloid films in a year. But by the 90s, when the economy got so very bad, the number dropped to about 1 celluloid film in a year because you needed so much money to go and process the film. So when the economy dealt with them and brought the level of production down, technology, determined the next move that we had to do. Of course, we are familiar with the theory of technology determinism. And so at that time, VHS came in. The video home system was introduced. So it meant also that people had to stay at home to watch films, but not celluloid films, because you have to reduce them to video to be able to watch at home.
And now you're jumping ahead.
Yeah, well, so I moved from the 70s.
I'm going to interrupt you. We're going to get to VHS.
Okay, well.
I just want to hear a little bit about the history.
Okay, so we had an established cinema tradition and culture in the 70s. Mm. So it didn't start with video. Mm. It started with celluloid films until we now dropped to videos. And then today we've caught the digital wave too. And so celluloid too is not something we should be talking about now.
And those early films, B, I wanted to ask you, those earlier films of Nigerian cinema, the dramatic structure, is it the same as what we think of as Nollywood films today, or was there a difference? And how did that affect you as you were coming up and screenwriting and directing?
I was born and I grew up in a small town in northern Nigeria called Kafanchan. And of all the filmmakers that Shoaibu just mentioned, the only one whose films I had the opportunity to see, were those of Hubert Ogunde and Babasala. They traveled all over the country. But my kind of education in film, even though at the time I didn't actually realize I was going to become a filmmaker, was at my local cinema, which was an old warehouse that got transformed into a cinema by virtue of benches being put in it and a projection. Yeah, it's a makeshift cinema. And a projector was put at the back. And we would go and watch Bollywood films and karate movies. And I probably watched about 500, maybe nearly 1,000 of those movies there. And it had a profound effect that I didn't realize on my aesthetics. We had a way of watching movies where, if for instance, we were watching a Bollywood movie, we needed something to happen every 3 minutes. And if there was no action, we started shouting action to the operator. We call it. And, so my education as a filmmaker actually started with those films, and later on with American cowboy movies. Mm. And it wasn't until many years later when I was at university that I saw, for instance, a film by Eddie Ugboma. And then I haven't seen anything by Ade Love. I've been bugging his son, Okunle. And I unfortunately haven't seen any films by any of those veterans.
Is that because there's not a print that's available?
They were paranoid about piracy. They were for good reason. Yeah. So it's very, very difficult to get hold of. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And is there, I would ask you, Shaibo, is there any kind of national archive in Nigeria that where people can have access to these older celluloids, or no?
Well, that's the unfortunate part of the development of cinema and movies in the country. We didn't take that part of the journey seriously. And we have a national archive, but I can say that when you go there, perhaps the only thing that has been archived there is a building. Mm. You don't have those materials there. It's sad that you cannot find a print of some of those films that he saw, that we all saw today, because we didn't think that it was possible to get those prints and keep them somewhere to make references to them. Mm. Some of them, like Chief Ugboma, claims that he has some of them in his room, but the last time I checked, I found out that you can't touch those films again because they were negatives, and he kept them in a poor storage facility, and the things are so melted now that you cannot touch them. And I wept because these are things that we could have referenced. A lot of people thought that we started with video, but no, we had a cinema tradition. But how can you point to that without archiving? So we don't have a very serious archiving system, and it's unfortunate. I mean, not too long ago, we wanted to do a documentary on Nigerian independence, and the folks at the TV station were still going to the UK to get footages to use, and it's sad. Yeah. So we need to take that aspect very seriously, the aspect of archiving.
Actually, let me just add a little thing. I think if we're talking about Nollywood, more than the 70s films, the biggest influence, I think, was TV, Nigerian TV.
I was just going to ask that. Yeah. So when did television enter the Nigerian culture and become popular? And what happened? What was the effect of so many people watching television at that time?
Oh, well, interestingly, television came in the 50s. Mm-hmm. The first television station was in 1959, you know, and then it grew. But we also discovered that television did not support the growth of the other industries, because Nollywood would have been far, far better if television supported its growth, if television stations could commission works. And then by that way, once they commission works, you are sure that those works, you will meet them years after. Mm. But television was popular. A lot of people watched television up to the 90s. In fact, one of the ways by which Nollywood became very popular was television, because some of the early stars of Nollywood were famous faces on television, on some of those television programs like soaps and all that. So television, even up to today, television doesn't commission works, unlike in other parts of the world where you find a television station commissioning series, commissioning works, but now they don't do that.
Yeah, but actually, I'm just going to add one thing. I think Nollywood actually came out of the ashes of Nigerian TV. It died completely in the 80s and the 90s. It's come back now, but I think Nollywood would not exist if. Yeah. So.
Interesting. CJ, I wanted to ask you, since you are kind of the latest and brightest that we have in Nigerian cinema, who were your influences? What were you affected by when you were growing up watching whatever? And how did that influence what you're doing today?
I remember it was... when you talk about Nigerian TV was quite diverse. I remember growing up, some of my favorite shows were used to have a show on TV called Hot Cash, popularly known as Willy Willy. It was very, very huge. It was watching.
Why are you guys laughing?
Because we all remember Willy Willy. I remember being really afraid. It was like horror for me.
Okay.
Yeah, I remember. I used to fascinate me a lot watching that. I mean, watching it now, it would probably be like very cheesy, but we had Hot Cash. We had. I came in late. I was born in the mid '80s. So, when I started watching TV, I started like really very young. Even though like at first they wouldn't let me watch some of the stuff on TV, but they realized, like, all my elder siblings realized that, and my parents realized that I had, like, strong fascination for TV. And they didn't win, you know, eventually. They let me, you know, watch some of the late-night programming. I remember on TV they used to have late-night movies. Mm-hmm. And I think the first film I remember seeing, like, the first feature film I can actually remember from, I think when I was 3 or 4, would be Sam Raimi's Evil Dead. And I remember because they used to play it like every Friday night and they wouldn't let me watch. But, you know, after bugging them for so long, they eventually let me watch.
Okay.
And I remember seeing it for the first time, and it wasn't really scary to me. It was more fascinating than scary. And I remember what was most appealing to me about the Evil Dead was because my elder siblings had built up this hype, you know, around it. Like, you know, like, I'm going to have nightmares if I see this. I'm going to have, you know, I expected to see, you know, beasts and monsters. But I remember what fascinated me most about the Evil Dead was when I sat through to watch the entire film on our black and white TV, I didn't see a single monster, just the POV of, you know, this moving thing chasing people around the woods. And I think for me that was like my indoctrination into suggestive storytelling.
Okay.
And, you know, understanding that, you know, you don't always have to show every single thing. And I think I pretty much decided to be a filmmaker, even though I didn't know what a filmmaker was.
So, but is it safe to say then that your influences are also Western?
Yeah, that's why I started by saying the television then was very diverse.
Right,
it was very, very diverse.
Okay.
I remember seeing The 39 Steps by Alfred Hitchcock on our black and white TV.
Okay.
I remember seeing Equalizer 2000, you know, the cheesy stuff, the serious artsy films.
Yeah.
Even films like The Seventh Seal from, you know, your country, countrymen.
Ingmar Bergman.
And it was, you know, like, it was really diverse.
Okay.
Really very diverse.
Okay. Interesting. So there's a difference, I would say, in the backgrounds. Does anyone know what is considered the first Nollywood film to us in the West? You can shout it out if you know. A film called Living in Bondage, which came out in 1992, and that's considered sort of the VHS beginnings of Nollywood. Although, Shaibu, you are doing this. Tell us why.
I disagree completely.
Yes, why?
It only made production of movies on VHS and on VHS popular, but it was not the first. Because even the man who funded the film, his name is Kenneth Nebu, is an evangelist now, who funded the film, funded other VHS productions before he did Living in Bondage.
Mm-hmm.
And those ones too were on the VHS format. So it couldn't have been. But what made Living in Bondage popular was that they used actors that were already names on television. They used locations. Usually what we had before then was to just shoot a drama, to shoot like a traveling theater drama on stage and package it in a video and sell it out. But now they use locations. People could see cars actually moving and somebody stopping out and hailing a friend on the street. They saw ritual scenes done in in grooves, not in rooms and all that. So it became popular, and then it was a story that connected to the people, because at that time there was so much noise about ritual killing, people making money from sorcering and all that, you know. So it appealed to the people, and then even though it was done in Igbo language, but subtitled, a lot of people said, no, this is something we should be watching.
And we have a clip of it. So let's watch just 15 seconds of Living in Bondage so you can see what we are referring to.
All right.
So I think that Living in Bondage, when I went to film school, that was what we were taught, was the first Nollywood film. And I understand now that there's a complex history behind it. So we cannot take for granted what we even are learning in the universities about Nigerian cinema. And that's why we have this great panel here, is to dispel these myths. But so I would ask you, the whole panel, we saw this clip. It's very characteristic of those early sort of VHS films. What were the characteristics, really? We know low budget, but what else?
I think low budget and fast turnaround of films. So we always talk about with Nollywood, you know, it's 20 to 50,000 to get a film out, and it can be in 1 or 2 weeks. And that compared to obviously Hollywood is very, very different. So it's mass production filmmaking.
Anything else in terms of production values or language, or was there anything, an acting style maybe, or the acting styles different?
I think it was more exaggerated than, you know, we have now. And I think people connected to it, you know. Not that they don't connect to what we're doing now, but people connected to it. And like he said, there was a lot of, it had a lot of ritual and voodoo features.
Yeah,
because it was what was going on in the country at the time.
Yeah.
So.
And this sort of cultivated a very strong style, I would say, and taste in the audience. And I feel, just as an outsider, that the audience is everything when it comes to Nollywood and Nigerian cinema. I mean, without this vibrant audience and this very, they have a connoisseurship of the films. I mean, Inya, you were telling me yesterday that you can almost say line for line.
Yeah.
Tell the story.
I was saying to her that when I watch, it's not just to watch for entertainment. I can feel what they're saying, and a lot of us do that, and we learn the lines. So when we're watching films, you know, you'd remember the lines if you're watching it again, and you can almost remember the expression. You can remember who said what and how they said it.
But Nigerians, we have a sense of the absurd, and so you watch this films and they're very camp, and we kind of love that, and then we kind of replicate them, and we're kind of messing with them, but actually also loving.
and we find that a lot of films, slangs emerge from a lot of films. You watch a film and the slang is used and it becomes a national thing.
Like what? Give us an example of what, let's say.
Aki and Popo have a lot of, you know, a lot of slangs. I have a plan. You know, when Papa always says, I have a plan, you know, and then, you know, a lot of my friends say to me, I have a plan. So I think, yeah, and that's a...
This other film by Funke Akindele, Geneva. Now, if you want to describe the big girls, you say,
Big girls.
You know, so they can pick the scenes from those films and, you know, they can identify with them and all that, you know, and they like, you know, the dialogue, you know, they can... It's not, it's like most of the time I complain that some of the films, they like just to talk. They can just sit down in a scene and talk for 5 minutes.
Yeah.
You know, and all that. But it has moved. It has moved on.
Some of the early films, you know, you'd have a scene where at the very beginning, you know, two people and one of them would say, you're my son, I'm your father. Your mother died. I mean, we've moved on.
Yes, we have. Yes, we have. So. Even from your film, 50, I remember when Omonyoboli said, 30 is the new 50. Remember that part?
Yeah, yeah.
I always tell my 50-year-old friends, 30 is the new 50. So, yeah. Uh-huh.
So these films are more than just films for the audience. They really become part of people's everyday living lives. And I know that in the West we have that, but I think that our approach to film is a little bit more like it's sacred or precious, whereas here it's every day. We just live with it, which I really appreciate. But so, Justine, I wanted to ask you, given the strong audienceship, what is your, for Iroko, which is the VOD platform that most Nollywood films are on right now, what is your viewership demographic?
I would say predominantly women. And I think, I mean, the interesting thing with us, we're trying to, in a future-proof the business. So we've recently launched an Android app for Africa. Mm. So what we found, obviously, across Nigeria, Kenya, Tanzania, where Nollywood films are really popular, was that streaming is virtually impossible because the infrastructure is so poor. Mm-hmm. So we've now got a download-only app that we've recently launched. So the viewership is, we are going for mass market. A subscription service on our app is $1.50 a month, so it's a subscription service. So we're really going for the mass market, and that's across Africa. And then we've got another model which is outside of Africa, which is really just a straightforward licensing model, which is, you know, I will go and talk to different platforms, whether it is Labara, whether it is pay TV platforms across the UK, France, wherever, and license films and TV series. Mm-hmm. So those are really the two models, very distinct, but predominantly what I'd say is slightly more women will watch the content than men. The statistics I've seen is around 60% women, the rest men, but it's quite hard to get really up-to-date figures, and I don't know whether my fellow panelists have other figures they have in mind, but that's really when we're producing content, that's what we have in mind.
And what is the relationship between Nigeria and the Nigerian film industry in Ghana?
Well, when we talk about Nollywood, we really include in that a number of other producers and directors who may be Ghanaian, maybe Kenyan, and so on. I think for us, Nollywood really represents the film industry hub for Africa. So it's very much, you know, a comparison to the way people think of Hollywood. It's not necessarily based in one area. It can be across the US. Mm-hmm. So that's the way we sort of talk about Nollywood.
Okay. I think that Shirley from Pogmanso is a good example of a sort of crossover Ghanaian director who considers herself a Nollywood director. Is that safe to say, Shaibo?
Well, yeah, it is, because they have also found that there's a big market, you know, mm-hmm. in Nigeria. And for them to be able to break into that market, they need to use some of the stars, because the star system works so well in Nigeria. So they used to use some of the actors in the country. And once you have an actor, like 2 to 3 actors in your film, automatically you can describe that film as an Hollywood film. So a lot of them have had, you know, to come and play in the country. We have someone like Frank Raja Arase, mm-hmm. yeah, who is a Nigerian, but he's based in Ghana. So he has been able to make that cut across. So you really cannot get a distinction. The only difference is that the person is of Ghanaian origin,
yes.
But the content is like a Nollywood, typical Nollywood content.
And I think it's a testament to how strong the Nigerian market is and how strong the Nigerian creativity is, that they want to also have that cooperation.
I think, I mean, just to add to that, it's, you know, it's amazing how far Nollywood has traveled or is traveling. Mm-hmm. So we are focused on Africa, but we're focused also outside of Africa.
Right.
If you think about the African diaspora, it
exactly.
is absolutely massive. So we're finding huge interest across the UK, obviously, the mm-hmm. US, Canada, but we've also are working very closely with partners in France for French-speaking Africans. Mm-hmm. So Nollywood is really very popular, but not just within Africa.
Yeah.
And I think also more broadly, you know, if you watch, you know, a Nollywood film, it talks and resonates with anyone. It is about, you know, finding a partner, a husband, mm-hmm. bringing up your children, the role of religion in your life. So those themes travel really worldwide, is my
yes.
view.
I wanted to go to the star system because it's so strong in Nigerian cinema. Inya and CJ, I know CJ, you are not using so many of the famous stars of Nigerian cinema. Why?
Can't afford them.
You don't want Mercy Johnson or anyone like that.
Seriously though, the reason is because when I made my first film, Ojuju, was it's a zombie film, and I wanted to tell, I wanted to make a subversive zombie subgenre film. Mm-hmm. That paid homage to the George Romero classics that I grew up, mm-hmm. you know, watching, without making a Hollywood zombie film. So for me, it was about, you know, kind of like finding that balance, mm-hmm. And telling that story in within the Nigerian context. And one of the things I did was, you know, eliminating the word zombie from the film and replacing it with the word Ojuju, which is actually pop culture in Nigeria. It's, you know, it's not commercialized pop culture,
right.
But you know, it's an urban myth, and people use the word Ojuju to scare their kids, you know, to submission. So I felt it was something that had that, you know, Nigerian resonance.
So I think these are stylistic choices that really give a different texture to your films versus like earlier films. Mm. I wanted to ask you, do you feel as though you want to be a Nollywood director, or do you feel as though you just want to be a filmmaker who happens to be Nigerian?
Well, it's a slippery slope. I'm really not crazy about, you know, whether it's called, the industry is called Nollywood. I don't think the name really matters, you know, what you call it. I just think that, you know, we've come to a point where we have, you know, all this attention, you know, on the industry, and we have to decide what we want to do with that attention.
Yes.
You know, and I think, you know, it pays us to take that, you know, to take that attention and, you know, steer the course, you know, of, you know, our industry's destiny by ourselves and determine the kind of stories we want to tell, because mm-hmm. there's just so much that we have to offer, so many stories that we haven't even begun to explore. And I always say this every time I get the opportunity to say that, you know, Hollywood as Hollywood is, the way Hollywood is structured right now, you know, Hollywood is pretty much done. You know, story-wise, you know, every single thing coming out of mainstream Hollywood is, you know, just reboots and sequels and, you know, and prequels. Mm-hmm. But we haven't even begun to scratch the surface of, you know, our storytelling. Mm-hmm. And I think any would-be investor, would-be executive producer, would-be producer, would be smart to realize that, you know, Nollywood is where the smart money is.
Can we get a clip of O-Town, which is CJ's film that's featured now at Gothenburg? Yeah. So we see a progression in the quality of the production, of the, I would say, stylistic choices that you made in terms of composition and color and sound and music. So there's been lots and lots of development, and some would call this the Nigerian New Wave. All of you have pointed to piracy as being one of the biggest challenges. Let's start with Justine. What are some of the creative solutions that you think you could come up with to combat that?
Well, piracy is a major problem. So we will take legal action against anyone who does pirate, and we're very clear about it. So we send what's referred to as cease and desist letters. But what we, our stance now is to say that if we get a really good product out in the market, which is the app, and it is cheap, so it's mass market, what we're hoping is people do want to see quality content, so they'll come to the app. I think realistically, it's very, very difficult to squeeze out all piracy across Africa. It is just impossible to do. Right. We can release a film, and within days, there's pirated versions out there. So really, it's two stances. We will go after those who pirate pretty heavily. Mm-hmm. And secondly, just to make sure in the market, we've got something that is very affordable. Someone knows they come on the app and they see good quality content, because most of the time, pirated content is pretty poor quality.
Okay. Shaiba, what do you think? You were saying, we were talking earlier, and you were saying that we could even use the pirates in some way.
Yeah. But we need to solve the issue of distribution in the industry. And I mean, I like the intervention by Iroko and some other video platforms who are trying to create, you know, other platforms. But we need to solve distribution. You see, when the films don't get out in time and to where they are supposed to get out, the tendency is for a pirate to feast on it and to get it. And then we need to invest in replication too, because it's presently too expensive. Even going to cinema now is even very expensive in the country. Not that you 1,000 naira, which we pay, which is like a dollar or so. Is it a dollar now because of the increase? About $5 we pay to see a film. It's not even the issue, but the cost of even going to the cinema to watch the films, because they are in elite areas. Then the other thing that we need to do across Africa to reduce piracy, because like she said, it's difficult to eliminate piracy, it's to educate people and then make piracy an economic crime. Piracy is not an economic crime in the country. That's why those guys will sell an intellectual property on traffic. I just told you now that somebody was coming into the country to premiere a film, and right in traffic, they were selling the copy of the film to him. It was that bad. Now pirates could even call you up to say, oh, we hear your film is in the cinema. You said, yes. We hear it's going to be released like in a month's time. You say, yes, okay. I think we want to release it on Monday. They will send a text message to you, so bad. So we need to solve the problem of distribution. Now, where they sell films in Africa, you could actually count the hubs in Africa. In Lagos, in Nigeria, you can say Aba, in Lagos, in Kano. But these films have to get to everywhere. And then we also have to take advantage of technology. I'm very happy when she talked about apps now, developing apps and all that. We really need to take advantage of technology to make it, to frustrate the pirates. Because they don't go that, they can't try that area because it's very expensive, you know, so they won't go that area. So there's a lot we need to do. And then the filmmakers themselves must also try as much as possible to invest in protecting their works, you know. And they must also try to exploit, perhaps follow the line of distribution.
That's what I wanted to ask. Yeah. B and CJ, sorry, Justine, I'm going to get back to you afterwards. How are you protecting your art?
I'm not a producer, I'm a director, so I don't actually get involved in that aspect of production. But I understand that piracy in Nigeria is actually perpetrated by some of the very people who the marketers, you know. So it's basically the poacher,
the ranger, the person who's meant to be protecting the animals, that's actually also poaching them, you know, which makes it very, very difficult. Mm. I mean, I think that there simply isn't yet the political will in Nigeria by government to do anything.
Are you feel about this? I mean, how, when your films are coming out, they're coming out in the cinema, and then how do you protect your work? I mean, what steps can you take, do you think, as a filmmaker?
Well, I haven't released any of my films in the cinema.
No.
The reason, because I really don't think the cinemas work to the advantage of the Nigerian filmmaker. Mm-hmm. Not when you're competing with Iron Man 5.
Okay.
You know, just won't work. Mm-hmm. And then there just isn't enough of them to go around.
So then how does your film, how is it seen if it doesn't go to the cinema?
So because of that, we had to find alternative ways to show our films. So far, when we exhaust the festival circuit, what we do is we take it to the VOD and TV, the VOD and TV and mobile platforms. So those are the avenues that we, and luckily for us, we just haven't, the pirates haven't set eyes on our works yet. we haven't been that unlucky.
Okay.
Yeah.
How are we on time? 10 more minutes. Justine, quickly, the final word on the pirates.
I was going to say, in terms of, I mean, I think my panelists have mentioned that already, cinema is really not a big way of releasing films.
No.
I think there's a handful of cinemas, and I think in terms of revenue, it is absolutely tiny. So I think the key in terms of piracy is really, I think, technology will win over. So that's what I'm saying, in terms of you get things online, straight out, onto the app, very quickly, so there's not much chance of someone getting hold of a copy and trying to burn it and then sell it that way.
Got it. How about if we open up to the audience for any questions? Yes. Yes, please. Here in the front. You can shout.
Is this good?
Yeah.
All right, obviously. It's really nice to see you guys. I'm from Nigeria myself, and I have a few questions about what you guys think about human rights, because I know how it is in Nigeria, but the laws on human rights, homosexuality, and things like that. And I was just wondering, as a filmmaker and director and producers, what are your view on that? Is it something you want to change, or is it something you would like to put in movies so people can, see how it's like? You know, change the views, because
what aspect of human rights?
Homosexuality, to start with. If you get a message through the movies, I'm sure a lot of people would also maybe think twice before they throw a stone or something like that, you know, just to send a message to say it's okay, it's not as bad as people think it is. Because I know in Nigeria, religion drives a lot of most of the things, and I know that, I understand. And then you have to be a man and a woman and everything like that. So it's just, what are your views on that?
Well, I mean, personally, I think when Jonathan, the previous president, enacted that law criminalizing homosexuality, I think it was pretty opportunistic, but pretty stupid. And I wasn't quite sure why he did it. I around the time, I was directing a series for MTV called Sugar. And I put a team of writers together and then ultimately rewrote everything. And we originally had a character who was meant to be gay. And the MTV people in London went to Abuja. They had meetings with people with, like, you know, lots of powerful politicians. Yeah, and you know, and basically we said, well, you know, we should have at least one gay character, since we know statistically that there are bound to be lots of gay people in Nigeria, and they were giving signals. They said, yes, you know, you could do this, and we wrote the character. And a few weeks before we went into production, I live in London, I was going to fly to Lagos to start production, and
I got an email from MTV in Camden in North London, and they wanted to have a meeting with me, and I went in, and they said, we just came back from Abuja and everything has changed, and the government, we've been told that the government would not allow us to have a gay character in it, and if we do have a gay character in it, they were not going to allow the series to be shown on Nigerian TV. Now, they had to kind of weigh, you know, what was more important. The thing is, Sugar was about educating people about HIV. Mm-hmm. Nigeria has about 4.2 million people who are living with AIDS or HIV. And so in the end, it was decided that to lose this battle, but, you know, hope. I mean, personally, I think it's Africa has lots of problems. You know, homosexuality is not one of them. But we also live within a culture. Jonathan was able to get away with it because he was actually supported by a lot of, you know, by most Nigerians. You know, you have a very conservative, pretty hypocritical. Mm-hmm. Way, yeah. You know.
I just add, I mean, it's a really interesting question because mm-hmm. There's a question about what films are being produced, and there's a question also about what the audience wants to view. So within my team, we've got what's referred to as the QC team, so quality control, so they will watch every single film and make sure that the sound quality, picture quality are good, but also we've been told to edit out a number of scenes. And those instructions have come from some of our key partners across Africa. So some of the big pay TV platforms are, you know, they are very conservative. So films do exist where there are gay scenes. There's all sorts of other types of scenes, but we are instructed to edit them all out.
But can I just say, isn't it that there's also, following up on your question, that there is a richer cinematic landscape that involves directors like Zina Sarawiwa, who does talk about these issues, and she's doing...
They're not shown,
I know, but there are, I mean, I think that there are some Nigerian directors who are tackling them, but it's not breaking through into them.
That's what I'm saying, yeah. is we have... Our library is something like 3,000 films, and we're going through a whole process of cleaning up our library. And there are a number of films that tackle all sorts of different issues, whether it is divorce, incest, homosexuality, all sorts. And, you know, the instructions we have from the platforms we work with is that really they're very conservative. Mm-hmm. We have to edit those out. If we don't edit those out, we send a film to X platform in South Africa or yeah. X platform in Nigeria, and the film will be rejected. Mm-hmm. So it is interesting. It is, those films are being produced. Mm-hmm. I think the producers and directors are interested in covering those themes.
Yep.
The issue now is, pushing along the platforms to become much more open to these types of questions to be answered on film. And right. I think that's where we're stuck at the moment.
Time for one more question, perhaps? Yes.
Hi. My question is about Nigerian marketers, which is a problem that is a very common problem to all of you directors and producers of films. And what I want to ask is, do you think there will be a chance? Because if you look at the marketers in Nigeria, it is almost impossible to fight them, not because of who they are, but because of their outreach. I mean, in some way, however illegal it might be, they produce, they create a lot of employment. You have people on the streets who are vendors for them. You have hundreds of thousands of people working for these marketers. That's where their power lies, that those people will still go to them and get those pirated CDs and DVDs and sell them in traffic, regardless of what anyone says, because that's all they have for work, and that's how they make their daily bread. So I just want to ask, would you at some point, as the industry, find a gray area where you can work with these people, negotiate with them, bring them to the table? And it's not, what you're doing is not legal, but I think they have that reach that is almost impossible to duplicate in Nigeria. It's very hard to create that kind of reach? They've developed that over the years.
I think it's a very good point. And, you know, we talk about wanting to have street teams in Nigeria. So going out, I suppose, to sell iRoka, sell the app, maybe what we should do is approach these pirates and say to them, listen, start selling our app. I don't know. I mean, it is really tough because I think there is a big market, but it's a market that we need to be careful not to encourage. So if you're giving them gainful employment elsewhere, I don't know whether it's going to encourage them more. It's a really difficult question.
I think it's actually, if there was a political will to stop it, it would take 5 seconds. I mean, somewhere like Lagos State is so... like if you see, you're from Nigeria, I think. In Lagos, you see people selling bread, you know, on the street. They pay tax. Like, you know, the local government basically has the details of everybody. And so if they really want to tackle, I think someone is making a lot of money, you know, and that's why it's, you know, if they want to, eventually something will happen, someone will give, and it will be solved.
Actually, he took it from my mouth. It's a political will. It's possible to get them, you know, to be part of, you know, the whole process of distribution and actually making money for the filmmaker. But you just find out that government has continued to play lip service. And it's actually government that can do this, that can bring that synergy. It's not the filmmaker. The man is interested in cranking the camera for the next film. He is not there to go and be talking to some guys who just want to make money where they did not sow, you know. But government needs to get them. Like he cited an example of Lagos. There is, and each time Lagos wants to do something, they enact an edict. Go against that edict and then you're on your own. Governor Fashola did something one time. He wanted to ban street trading. And these guys were resisting the ban. And he says, no, don't touch them. I will do something that will stop them from getting on the street. And then he opened up the roads and he planted flowers everywhere. So there was nowhere to even walk on Ozumbamba, the way to sell on the streets. So if you go and stand there, so you need to do something that will discourage them from getting involved. At the moment, the market in Alaba is so unstructured, and the only people that can structure the market in Alaba is government. Distribution is poor in the country. The only way we can get distribution all over the country is still the government, because the government has permits and everything. And to answer her question, the only way we can allow open access to some contents in the country is also to go back to government and to get them to begin to see how they can change some of those laws. I mean, be directed half of a Yellow Sun, and there was a whole story about how the film did not get shown, you know, for some time, because the censors board was insisting that what was just a way of telling a story is considered something that can incite the public, as if they conducted a survey to find out that it would actually incite the public. So there's so much that the government has to do to encourage development in the Nollywood industry.
Final word from CJ.
Okay.
About this.
Pressure.
Yes, just about this.
Okay, I just wanted to say something real quick. If you're a Nigerian filmmaker and you're making Mr. Ibu Goes to School, for example, I don't think you're going to have a problem with distribution. But if you're making a 50, you might have a problem with distribution. So it would seem like, you know, what people call new Nollywood or new Nigerian cinema or whatever, new wave, whatever it is, the people who are most hit by the lack of distribution. Because you put in a considerable amount of work getting your films made, and you want to get value for, you know, the amount of money that you put in. And the Alaba structure, that's what you call that structure where you get films being sold on the streets, is called the Alaba. Because of the market. That structure doesn't work for the new wave of filmmakers. It just doesn't work because you're not going to make money from it. Your films will be pirated and you just won't see a dime. But for the other guys who are making films for very cheap and they churn out by the dozens, you know, they get their films distributed, well distributed. I mean, you go into every single house and you find their DVDs, their VCDs, and they enjoy more fame. You know, I mean, I can walk down the street and no one recognizes me. But if the guys who make Mr. Ibu Goes to School, they can't walk down any street. No. They'll be mobbed.
Yeah. Actually, I'm gonna add a little thing. Like, you know, the music industry, which is thriving,
yes,
doesn't face the same problem. The same marketers actually would, if a musician is bringing out a new album, they approach them and they pay them. They pay them for like 1 million copies, 2 million copies. They've got an arrangement, and the same thing can happen with film.
One last question, please. I've said that 3 times now, but really one last question.
Oh, yeah, I'm so thankful that you brought filmmakers. Of course, if you make a 50, it won't help because it's the big production. But I'm curious on how piracy can... you already said a lot about it, but... I'm just curious if you could develop a bit on the new Nigerian scene and the other, and how they live together.
Yeah. All right. They don't. the reason why I say that is because the gatekeepers,
yeah,
of the Alaba scene, the people who control the market, they hate us, mm-hmm, and they hate our guts because they think that we don't want to have that dialogue, but we do want to have that dialogue. I mean, but for some reason they see us as a threat to the status quo, and because of that they would rather find that dialogue. I would like to have my films, you know, everywhere.
Right.
You know, I mean, I would definitely be open to that, a way to get your movie and pirate it, you know, without your knowledge. So because of that, it just kind of like makes people just, you know, not even want to come anywhere near those guys. But there's a difference, you know. When you have a movie like, I always use Mr. Ibu for example, because this guy, he's really huge. Yeah, he's a comic character. And I can guarantee you that every time he's on a film, his movies sell for millions of copies all across the country, in DVDs and VCDs.
And outside the country.
And even outside the country. He enjoys enormous fame. He doesn't go anywhere without being mobbed. He's very popular. And there are so many of them, you know, like that. But in the new Nigerian scene, the new Nigerian cinema scene, even though these actors and these filmmakers enjoy considerable amount of fame, but it isn't anywhere close to what the other guys are enjoying. It's just not even anywhere near, not even within the ballpark. You just have a few people who know them, who manage to watch Nigerian films in the cinema, or a few people who watch satellite television and know them. But beyond that, they could walk down the street and no one knows them.
And why is that? Is it from the...
It's because it's art house cinema.
Yes, the tastes are different.
Yeah, the tastes are different. Yes. Yeah. The tastes are different.
And coming from a manager's point of view, there are some people who's been in the new, you know, wave films, and they've also had a bit of the Asaba movies or, you know, whatnot. And it's a mix. It's also a discussion on whether, you know, to grow your brand, whether you have to do both. Whether you have to set out and say, oh, this is a fantastic script, I see that it's going international, it will go to the cinemas, or to say, yeah, maybe when I do 5 of those, I kind of need to do one of that one as well, you know, just so this side of people will know me.
Justine, do you have any new wave films on Iroko, and how do they do?
We tend to focus more on what we're sort of see as Nollywood films, and particularly things like TV series. So I don't think we do have any sort of new wave, new Nollywood films on our platform. That's not to say we shouldn't, and I think we probably should start looking at that. We just had a quick chat about whether we should distribute this guy's film.
Is that why you're there?
And I just wanted to quickly add, in response to your own question, that there might not be that marriage, and you know why? Because those guys want cheap products. Mm-hmm. The films that he's saying have sold 5 million copies and all that are made with a budget of about 3 million, 4 million naira. So you cannot make
whole town. You cannot make 50 with so much money, and then somebody's offering you 1 million naira.
Sorry to cut you, but I actually made whole town for just about that amount.
Yeah, but I'm saying that you cannot make a film for 10 million. Just say, conservatively put, 10 million. And then you go to somebody who is telling you, okay, let me pay you 1 million naira in advance. It doesn't make sense. Because that's what they do. And these films sell for 100 naira. Like, for instance, I bought a film 2 weeks ago called Nkolika. Nkolika, yes. Very popular film. That film has sold close to 5 million copies.
Part 1 to 10.
But it was broken into 10 parts. And I bought each copy for 100 naira, which is there's no serious film that you sell for 100 naira and break even. But they sold it for 100, cut it into 10 parts, and I have to buy the 10 parts, up to 10 DVDs to be able to. That's how this film sells.
That's a great business model, I think.
You know, so it's difficult, except they up their game. They need to also learn to up their game. And that's why I'm hoping that there will be serious investment in the distribution industry in the country. Once you have serious investment, all these other guys will go to sleep. I mean, before Iroko came, some guys were mushrooming as VOD distributors. And by the time they came, they changed the game somehow. Mm-hmm. So if you have very serious people who are committed to distribution, the game will change, and Nollywood will just get there.
I think that... I want to thank all the panelists for all the insights that we've gleaned today from them. And it's obvious that Nigeria is a gold mine that we have yet to tap, as you said. It's a dynamic, moving, alive, vibrant film industry. And I hope we see more of you all. Thank you.